I can start with a very short overview of what's going to happen today, because it's kind of bits and pieces. The first third is going back to some of the pigments and the different perception of color and the scattering. And then I will start with the vibrational spectroscopic section. So I will just repeat a little bit from the big infrared seminar I gave last month or 2 months ago. So I repeat it more slowly with the background, and then I have one example from the archaeometry studies on where we use infrared spectroscopy a lot. And then next Monday, Ben will continue with all of Raman spectroscopy. And if we have time, yes, we can talk about the exercises. So I started on preparing a little instruction book, so that you have the exact composition of the glass samples and the exact task you're supposed to do, and the bit background of the instruments used and how to do that. So the UV-Vis part is almost done on the Raman. Ben is working as well, and in the infrared. And it's I think there are 5 of you now officially inscribed. Yes. And so I would say that one group is, well, 2 or 3 are doing the a silicate series, and the other one a fluoride phosphate glass series. And like with a microscope, you can measure lots of samples really quick, and in an hour you had lots of them. And then you measure similar samples for UV-Vis, infrared, and Raman, and see what the different instruments see, and if they see differences or not for what type of changes. Like UV-Vis is very sensitive for the dopants, but can't tell you much on the glass structure. Infrared and Raman don't see the dopants, or they see it at fluorescence. So, and we have a fluoride crystal and a SO2 crystal, so you have that in comparison to glasses. And so we just give you some questions for that. And then we have for each of you, you will get like 2 unknown samples, which we mixed up and forgot the name, or you can perhaps pick one from the vitrine, and just after the measurements, when you present your results, you can tell us why you think it's a manganese-doped phosphate glass or nickel-doped borosilicate glass. And the unknown samples I have, you will have glass matrix and dopants for comparison. So in the end, you can say, okay, this spectrum looked like manganese, the infrared is like a low alkali borosilicate. So you do have everything you need to do to say that. So every one of you gets some different unknown. And because you're the first to do this exercise, we have to see with time-wise how many things you can do. And there are some voluntary extra exercise for whoever wants to do those, but that can be some of the others as well, because we rather need that for a paper and not for grading. Okay, the first part is still about the color and the UV-Vis, but it's more about the less transparent. So it's more the pigments you have in glazings, and some glasses are not as homogeneous as you want them to be. And then you see those, like here it's a phase-separated Duran-type glass, a low alkali borosilicate glass. And if you really see where the laser scatters at all the little, just the 2 phases, and it keeps.
Is it phase separated for purples?
It's no, actually, this is a glass sample with bubbles, and it scatters at the bubbles. So you have the air-glass interface and different refractive index for air and the glass, and you get the scattering. Here it's a sodium borate-rich phase and a silica-rich phase. Okay. And they have slightly different refractive index and other things, so
Okay, but
the light will just scatter.
This happened. This is a problem. This happened.
It's doped with manganese, so it's if you cool it fast enough, we get a clear glass. Here we were a little bit slow, and so it's phase separated. That's the just a bubbly glass, which even if you polish it, will still show you the scattering. And
but normally you do not want phase separated.
No, well, for the Weicker glasses you want it, but often enough you don't want it. Sometimes it. No, it was a series. We doped until, well, there was air, doped as long as the phase separation started. So, was just studying the effect of manganese addition to this glass. This is a similar glass block. It's just really big. I think I do have a better figure of that later on, but it's still all about interaction with light waves with the material, or the scattering, and there are different types of scattering, like the Mie scattering, which you have in the ruby glasses. It's more on smaller particles. There's also the Rayleigh scattering that is also important for Raman spectroscopy. So we hear about that next Monday.
Do you know why one is called elastic and inelastic?
It's elastic if the difference remains the same. But if you lose energy or you gain energy, then it's the inelastic. And there's here the direction might change, but it's not losing the energy. I mean, of course, in ruby glasses, you have a combination. You have the scattering effect, and you also have surface plasmon resonance, and that absorbs and changes the energy. But it absorbs, so it's not changing the energy. It just takes it one energy out of the visible spectrum. I found two more things which I forgot to tell the last time. In general, we just have here the lifetimes and first here it's the emission and the excitation spectrum, and you see for glass and crystals the different forms. And then I was talking about the lifetime of the emission spectra. And that is actually given in this lifetime value tau epsilon. And that's measured as when the lifetime has dropped to value of 1 divided through epsilon. So the Euler-Schön number. So it's like 36.8%. So this is a value you often find in the literature. If you compare lifetimes, you just don't pick any of any value. You normalize your fluorescence intensity, and you start when it and measure the lifetime here when it drops to 1 divided by epsilon. So about 38%. And then you go down here, and this is the lifetime value you're giving. So the last time I forgot the number, so I had skipped over that. And here I checked, so they're both on this side, the transmission for the green and the red. So that's the tetrahedral manganese, which gives the green emission, and then the octahedral coordinated manganese 2+ that gives the orange, and just different amount of energy in the splitting. It's a D5 ion, and so you only have one diagram. For D7, the tetrahedral would go to one side and the octahedral to the other side, but D5, the octahedral and tetrahedral have the same diagrams. So both see them there, but this energy difference here, that's from that you can go to directly to the frequency you measure, and so the relative difference in energy you will see in different positions, like one in the red, the lower energy, and the green, the higher energy. But higher energy in terms of the energy of this axis. The other axis, that's the intensity, that's a different thing. Now, there are some examples now where the fluorescence plays a role, but also how you perceive a sample. So how it's the light that's available for looking at things. And you might know that in some clothes look very different inside the store or outside. And glasses may look different depending on the light you're using when you look at the glass. But first, this is a uranium-doped glass. And it looks, it's in the US you have a lot of depression glass from the time of the depression. They were colored with uranium. And Europe, there just was a time where they liked the green and green glasses. And if you put it under UV light, it will really fluoresce. And you see that they appear quite differently if you, here the light comes in this, comes from this side, front on the large sample, and you're looking on top of it. So you're looking here, which would be this. And this, just your position and the light position is exchanged. And you, so it's, because it's fluorescing, and this glass, it's also part that it's not just the thickness that gives you a different light expression, but it's the combination of the fluorescence from this uranium, and the thickness of the sample. And since the light scatters in all directions, it makes a difference from what direction you're looking at the light, yeah, if you have fluorescence, then your probe beam comes from one side. But then the sample fluoresces in all directions. So not only from in the side then. And it's where the glass itself is more, yeah, it's more green under the lamp. So when the, because it fluoresces in the green energy range.
Well, it's not clear why the color changed even from here to.
Well, here it's well, you, when you look with the light, then you have the combination of what's the light, and if you look from the other side, you only see the emitted light, or more of the emitted light. And it's... if you don't have any emission in this, then you would see more the difference in thickness. You also have... The phase-separated glass, it looks different if you look from it on top and if you look and have a light source on the other side.
Because and if you look in the
same place. But in that glass, it's a different reason. It's because the light scattering is wavelength dependent. and once you see the backscattered light, and if you look through, you don't see it because that's on the other side of your sample, and you just see what's coming through. So there are different reasons of why things have different colors. And there's one thing, it also depends on what light source you have here. If that doesn't give you the full spectrum, then you have a different overlap of absorbing bands from your sample. And but I will show some examples where you see why the color is different.
So in the second case, you have the sum of reflection and transmission.
Yeah.
In the first case, you see only transmission. In the up case, A.
You have the light from the, and then it's, the green is the emitted light that comes on top of that, what you see if you don't have fluorescence. And of course, yeah, and it's hard to sometimes to look directly with a light beam because that's just, yeah, usually you have to have it on the other side or behind you in the shade. So it's, but then you have the reflectance, and if you have the scattering, you just see what's emitted from the sample. And if you otherwise you have the combination absorption plus scattering, if you look with a light beam. If you come from the side, you would see only the scattering. This is one of the same glass, the absorption spectrum, so you don't see the scattering here. But it absorbs strongly at 400 something. So it's more of the blue that's cut out of the spectrum, so it appears yellow. And you see it's different thicknesses of the sample. So that's like if you have one plate, six plates, and 10 plates. So yeah, according to Lambert's law, Lambert-Speer's law, you expect to have less and less transmission. But you also see here that it's not going from 1 to 6 to 10. It's here, it's really just a little bit of decrease. And that's because the transmission is so low here that you have a saturation effect. So you're not in Lambert-Speer because you can't measure the transmission anymore because it's already so dark. And that's where you have to be careful with. Most commercial instruments, they stop measuring when you are at extinction values of 2, 2.5. And there are good some new instruments that can go to 10, and they will see those little differences really nicely, but not every instrument can do that, and so there is when you have to be careful with some publications, which, and if you measure your own samples. And then the best thing is just take your sample and make it thinner. Push it down until you're out of this, and like the red one or the black one, they're nice spectra, and they give you the full spectrum. Yeah. Yeah, it's transparent, but it's just that your spectrometer isn't sensitive enough to see the light coming through. And perhaps a stronger light source might help, but it's, yeah, the good instruments now that can go to extinction values of 10, only for really good, polished, nice, big samples. They can't do it with a small mask. They also need a larger probe beam. They made sure that they don't have any light loss inside the instrument. So it's totally black, it's no scattering, no reflectance, no nothing interfering with the light beam. And then they can be more sensitive. But if usually you lose part of the light beam somewhere during the path through the instrument, and then instruments are usually still good, you just go to a thinner glass sample. And we had like a cobalt metaphosphate glass, 50% cobalt 2 plus. It's a dark glass, it looks black, but if you polish it down to 10 micrometers, it's transparent. So,
you are saying that the two last sample does not follow the Lambert-Speer's law?
Probably if you translate in absorption, it won't, but not because, of course, yeah, there is a limit to Lambert-Speer too. If they start clustering and so, there might be a saturation effect, but this one, if you have a thin enough slide, it's not saturation due to Lambert-Speer, it's or due to concentration quenching, because the distance for each during mine, it's the same if you have a 1, 6, or 10 something thick sample. So if you go down, you get a good spectrum. So it's just your sample was too thick, so that the combination of concentration and thickness and molar extinction coefficient gives you an absorption that's too high for this instrument. So yes, go to a more expensive instrument or cut it down. And yeah, here you saw big absorption around 400, and that's the emission that's here in the green, and that's where the green color you get. That's the emitted green fluorescence. And the here 400 something that was violet to blue, so it cut off the bluish part of the spectrum and you are left with the yellow looking if you just look at it in reflectance on your sample absorption. And then if you look at the emitted light, you get the green. And there are all these color gamuts to give the exact color, since every one of us sees color slightly different. And we are great in distinguishing little nuances of color. And I don't know how many million different shades of color we can distinguish. But some people are perhaps more sensitive in the red and others more sensitive in the blue, and others mix green and blue and have just the brown color. And so everyone is different. And if you describe colors to someone, then everyone has a very subjective feeling of the color. So there are these diagrams that try to give you a value for the color. And it's usually on a yellow to blue axis, so that you find a value there, and then a red to green axis. And the third value is the density. It's like from white to black, just the darkness. And for fluorescence components, it's really easy to do that, and most spectrometer will just do it immediately. And there are also I have a little color cube at home. You just place it like here on the yellow thing, and it gives you the CIA values, or the LIB color space for this yellow material. And then you have a number, and you, like for catalogs, or you want to buy just this type of carpet or whatever. it's useful. Or you want to describe an archaeological piece and say the color. It's nice to get that, but with glasses, it's still a problem because they're transparent and the depth plays a role. And of course, the lighting is, you probably need a total normalized, standardized light source and a standardized thickness of your sample. And so there we still can't really do it. But for other colors, it's good possible.
Sorry, guys, but came back, what are the axes on this chart? The V and
the
U?
For this one, now I don't know off the hand. There are a lot of different LIB and RGB, and there are a lot of different ways of doing it. And one is more for fluorescing materials, others is more for non-fluorescence. And even the painting of these, you will find slightly different ways. And there have been new definitions every 50 years or something. But there's lots of literature if you Google it in the internet. It's a lot on.
Are the two different,
RGB or CYMK? Yeah, there are huge equations for U and V, where these values are then part of it. And this one tries to take this sensitivity of the cones and rods in our eyes into account. Because the red, the blue, and the green don't have the same sensitivity. so that's part of it. Yes, you have, these are the wavelengths actually outside. And outside you have the more intense color and the white is in the center. And there's somewhere here, I think, is a line of the black light emission, and so there are a lot of subparts in this. So that's a probably could talk 2 hours just about the different things. But it's a lot of fluorescence papers show this and show where their glass is positioned and how. And this would be a shift from the 1/6 and 10 millimeter thick one. So it's yes, because scattering depends on the number of ions, and so also the thickness, of course. A thick glass will give you more fluorescence than a thin film. Yes.
Which is 2, 6 and 10?
I don't know by heart. I can look it up, but that's, yeah.
It's very interesting.
Yeah.
So you see, depending on the thickness of the glass, the color is changing.
And that's a part of that. It's the color chapter Dominicus. I'm working with him on, and there was a lot of part which I wasn't aware with colors, which subchapters he included, and one was more of this, and there are some more examples now where we go from fluorescence to photochromism, and that's where I've doped eins, and there are a lot of examples from bachelor thesis and work from Alex Clare and Alfred University, and this is one of these. So under white light, a lot of rare earth dopants don't show very strong color, and under the black light, they do fluoresce. So, and yeah, some really nice blue and red, and others more yellow and orange. And yes, you can play with the coordination. I think samarium can give different colors depending on the coordination. But that's not the main thing. It is that this is the same glass doped with neodymium, and this is the same glass doped with holmium. But one is measured under an incandescent lamp, and the other one under cathode fluorescence, something lamp. So you're just going from to different light sources, and they tried to have a very controlled setup, and they went outside exactly at 12 o'clock to do the same thing with daylight and being outside the shade, and they just used quite a range of different lamps. And they measured the emission spectra of the different lamps, and some do have, yeah, are not a very continuous spectrum. We just have some wavelengths that are emitting much stronger than others, and others are really missing from it. And with others, you have a more continuous, F is daylight. And yeah, and this is just corresponding where you also see the different intensities of the bands. So from here, you just see, yeah, it's there, but not how. So like the CFL is this one, the blue, the green, and this orange line are really stick out. And they are very narrow emission bands. And what's this one? Sunlight. It's a huge intensity pretty much everywhere in the visible spectrum. And so this is samarium, and some are more greenish, gray, yellowish. And this are is the absorption spectrum. But here, first, it's the transmission spectrum of the, yeah, this time neodymium. And they look kind of bluish purple in daylight. And that's all of the, now it's from transmission into absorption bands. So all the bands that absorb also have enough light to absorb. Then you get this color. And then black body emission. So there's a gap here. And so there's less light that can be absorbed in the blue region. So it looks less blue, it's more pinkish. Here you have the incandescent light has a lot of red light and not much blue light at all. So the two peaks, the blue peaks, are pretty much totally not there. They can't absorb the blue light, and so it's even more pinkish. And here with this fluorescence lamp, you have very, very few strong photons coming at your sample, but you lack a lot of part of the spectrum, and so a lot of the red can't be absorbed. And now this weak green thing is suddenly really dominating together with the red. It's, yeah, you lose this pinkish colors. And so it's just the overlap of the photon that interact with your samples and the wavelengths your sample can really absorb from the absorption spectrum. And then you get to this different, yeah, here it's just shown again, if you take the absorption spectrum, or the excitation spectrum is pretty much the same as the absorption spectrum, but overlay it on the light source, then you see all the parts that can be absorbed. And yeah, in this case, you don't have much overlap. So you don't get such a strong colored sample. So that's for erbium, again, a lot of different colors. And that's what a lot of supermarkets also use. They say the tomatoes, they have a lump that only interacts with the red part of the tomato. They look much more red in the supermarket than outside, because they just find the light source that gives you the red and not the rest. Neodymium 3 plus, it's more the green turquoise. So that's just, and that's how the human eye, and for what wavelengths the different cones are sensitive for. And so the blue, the green, and the red, and the intensities are slightly different, so we each, and of course we don't exactly have, it's just an average depiction of where we are sensitive to, but it also shows that everything above 700 nanometers we are not really good in seeing anymore. And yeah, this is just another representation of this garment and the different areas. I don't remember what this was standing for, but it's so if you Google it, you will find lots of representation depending on what source, well, what application you want to use it. They pick out different regions of the thing. But it's, in a way, if you are a company that sells inks and colors, and so you have to have an objective way of giving a value of your color. And there have been, there's a book, or that youth people had this book, and that was more for museum and catalogs. And then you went through the book and find the right color. For the advertising community, they have, and it's really expensive to get those reference materials. They have like a just 100 different colors in one block, and you can buy one that's only focused on red, and one on blue, and one on green, and then they go, yes, I. And of course, if you are a big company and you copyright not just your name, but also the color that goes with the logo, then you have to copyright the exact color and not just, well, red is mine, no one else is allowed to take red in this combination. So it's for advertising, and then the Magenta Telecom thing has to be this Magenta, not a different one. So you need color values just to be able to give a number to that. This is actually an undoped borosilicate glass. So now we are getting more to scattering. But it's it was a big industrial melt. The thing has this size. And it was cooled quickly enough in this part that you don't have phase separation. And then at some point it just started to phase separate, and then you have this milky opaque effect. And then you have exactly, if you come with a laser, that's actually a better example than the little one, but I didn't bring the big block. When you start with a laser pointer on this direction, it passes through the glass and you don't have an interaction. No, I didn't bring a glass, but it's probably it should be by glass, like going through this bottle, you just see the that might hit the outside, but then it passes through the water without interaction. And exactly like this, it will pass through this part of the glass. And then you go into the, you come here and you see the laser pointer just scattering the lights scattering it at the different phases. And yeah, the Lycurgus cup was this famous Roman example where you, because of the scattering, it looks different in reflectance or in transmission. And
so the light is transmission.
Yes, they put a little light inside the cup and then it looks red. It's some gold silver alloy. So there are nanoparticles, and you have the combination of plasmon resonance from this metallic nanoparticles, and then you have scattering of light at the particles outside. And that's what they actually plotted here for different sized particles, between radius of 25 to 100 nanometers, how the backscattering and the incident radiation and the absorption and all these different factors, they each have their own wavelength dependence. And if they show this at very different wavelengths, that's why you can get a different color when you look in reflectance and then when you look in transmission. And it's... I want to go to this one. One is the typical example of why sunsets are red and the sky isn't blue anymore. That goes back to this scattering on all the particles in the atmosphere. And if you, I'm not explaining all the different terms of this equation, but the important part is here that there is a wavelength dependence that goes into this equation with a fourth power. So it has a very huge effect. And so if you have the blue light scatters to the fourth power more extensively in the atmosphere than the red light. And so the short wavelengths, they are scattered out first. And if you look, now you have to look through a lot of atmosphere to see the sun in the back, so you only see the red lights coming to you. And in a way that's,
What the red light, we only see the red light?
That's the long wavelengths, they scatter less, so they are able to pass through the whole thing. And if we go back to the Roman cup, in transmission we saw the red light coming through.
Okay.
Because the blue light, that scattered inside of the cup where we are looking from the outside. So the short wavelengths are scattered inside the cup, and we only see the long waves coming through. And the other thing was the Mie scattering, that is at smaller particles than the Rayleigh scattering. And the other thing is the Mie scattering is also not just a scattering in all directions, but it's it depends on the polarization of the light, and you can get some very complex pictures of if a light wave hits a particle, where it then goes to. And it depends, of course, on the geometry of the sample and the wavelength and the difference in refractive index inside and outside and the material, the polarization, and you get this cone-shaped things. And I'm not going to go into detail of what form you get at some place. And you probably have to talk to a physicist to get the details there. I just wanted to say that it's just and then you have the incident light wave and the scattered wavelength light, and they overlay and give you some complex figures, and that's how you might then see a corona like this. And when all the light waves interact with each other. But that's what we saw and I had mentioned that in the second lecture a little bit with these kappa-doped gases. And we do have a mix of small and big particles, and the bigger ones are responsible that we here have, again, this time we see red in reflectance and we see more bluish in transmission. So it depends, because this time we have a different size distribution of the particles and a different thickness than the Lycurgus cup I showed earlier. So it's different materials with different wavelength dependence. And here we do have some big particles which make a lot of scattering, which are probably the cause of the opacity in the samples. And then we have a lot of very small particles which are causing the red color and the plasma resonance of red. No? Yeah. And this was when the student in Jena then, from the reflectance measurements and absorption measurements, he got these three different spectrum. And then with the MiPlot simulation, that's a free software program, you can simulate how the reflectance spectra would look like if you have this number of this sized particles of this refractive index in the matrix of another refractive index. We know the refractive index of a soda lime silicate glass and of kappa particles. So now he was just trying to simulate just going through different particle distributions. And it's not showing that. No, the last time it gave a nice figure from that. That was when, so he plotted the number of smaller or larger particles for these three glasses. So now we know that one glass has more the 80 nanometer big particles, the other more the 60 nanometer big particles. There are lots of examples in glazes and where you have those, the coloring from pigments and not just from dissolving like cobalt ions or manganese ions in glasses. And yeah, and often you have a transparent glass matrix that's colored like here, or the cobalt colored glasses. And sometimes you have the color inside a glaze, or in a pigment. So the yellow one is a lead antimonate crystal that and you don't have a dissolved ion that gives you the red color there. These are Roman mosaic tesserae, so they made these huge wall pictures out of those. And some of them we could measure in transmission. This one was transparent enough. And some we had to measure in reflectance. And the way it's plotted, you just see that this is the inverse of the spectrum. So you have the typical three bands of cobalt. And it's cobalt ions dissolved in a glass. And they are then opaque because you do have some scattering crystals inside. They are white, actually. So it's a white scattering, well, or colorless. It looks white when the light scatters at them. But the blue color is dissolved in the glass matrix in this case. And you can find them by electron microscope, those crystallites where the light scatters. And from by X-ray diffraction, we found there are different antimonates and sometimes calcite. And there are two types of, there's one antimony oxide, and then there are two types of calcium oxide. And they look differently in the infrared, in the XRD, but also in the Raman spectra. And so one is the calcium SB206 and one the calcium SB207, slightly different structures. And this PhD student in Jena, Ferdinand, who's looking into some of the archaeological samples, he tried to, by different ways of crystallization, like the crystals in the mosaic tessery and in the glazing, if they just nucleated in situ by cooling of the melt, or if they never fully dissolved, they were just added to the glass. And so you found that the SB207, that's occurs at bulk crystallization, And the other one is more it's a surface crystallization thing. And so it depends on the temperature he was using and the little, yeah, if there's titanate or he gets different crystals than if there's tin in the glass. Only we will probably never really know if the Romans intentionally added titanium oxide or tin oxide to the glass, or if it's just something that came with the antimonades. So it's, but we do see that in a lot of mosaic tesserae, it's actually the bulk form, bulk crystallization, the SB207, and that in the Greek glazings, here in the white, you have the SB206, the calcium SB206, where you have surface crystallization. And now I'm already showing a little bit of Raman. It's where you, if you, with a microscope, you can easily find the little crystals. You measure the Raman and you can get some very, very well-defined bands due to these crystals. And you don't need to bother about the assignment of all the different bands. It's more like a fingerprint method. So there are databases and or just paper collections, and you find the spectrum that looks exactly like the one you have. And then you just by fingerprint comparison, you can say, okay, I do have calcite, I have anastase, I do have these two different types of antimonade in crystallizing here. And yeah, here this one is the Raman spectrum of the lead antimonade, that's the yellow color. And so here the yellow comes really from the microcrystallites, and it's opaque because you have the crystals there and the light scatters at the crystals. And now you can play a little bit with the color by adding iron to the lead antimonade, and it turns more greenish. Or you, like with the blue glass, you mix that with a blue cobalt glass with white opacifiers, then you get a opaque light blue color. Or the yellow with the blue glass, then you can also get more greenish colors. Yeah, that's one of the more greenish. In this, it's a mixed crystal with iron and lead. But you can also have a more blue glass matrix and then mix it together and get all nuances of color. Okay, that was the coloring thing, and the next part will be infrared spectroscopy and the introduction first to vibrational spectroscopy, and then an example of archaeological glasses. Now we go from the visible range to the infrared range and see what absorptions we get there. And so today I repeat a little bit of the infrared things and try to pick out only the more important ones from our last lecture. And next Monday, Ben is talking about Raman spectroscopy, and while the excitation, there are quite some difference between the two techniques, but they're complementary to each other and you see similar things. So it's often good to do both measurements on your sample and then get the combined information. We will see that where they show you the same or where they will show you different things of the same. So both techniques have different ways of measuring it. And for infrared, you will see a lot of papers measured in transmission mode or in reflectance mode or ATR, which is great for powder. So I will talk briefly about the advantages and disadvantages of these different techniques. And generally, up to now, we spoke a lot about dopants that give color. If it's nanoparticles or dissolved cobalt ions, often very low concentration of, like cobalt, you have 500 ppm in the glass, you have a quite intense color. Infrared and Raman won't give you those 500 ppm. If those ions are fluorescing, they might screw up the Raman spectra. So you will know if you do the Raman that you have something inside, but you don't get the same information on the dopants you would get with fluorescence spectroscopy. So, but what you will get, is the structure of the glass by infrared and Raman. So the glass forming units for which UV-Vis is kind of blind. It gives you the absorption edge, and that's related to the polarizability and the band gap and the bends, but it doesn't tell you if it's tetrahedral or octahedral, and it doesn't give you the number of non-bridging oxygen as directly as infrared and Raman spectroscopy. So this is more a structural technique. And here you will see the energy of different vibrations and different types of vibrations. These stretching modes are the ones with the highest energy. So that's the bands with the highest frequency you will see in the spectra. And it's usually the oxygen bonded to your phosphate or silicate, and the band position shifts with the number of connections to other polyhedra, or if it's a non-bridging oxygen. So you get a lot of important information from that. And then you have bending modes, and that can be the oxygen between two silicates or the silicate between two oxygens. So you have different type of bending modes. They are often a well-defined band, and so it gives you, it helps to find out the rate, the degree of polymerization. So how many bridging oxygen you have in the glass. And then there's all this twisting, wagging, torsion. It's all the tetrahedra in the case of silicate against each other, and it's often a broad combination band, and also summarized as deformation modes. If you look into a polymer, you can actually distinguish lots of those as small, fine bands. And of course, in a crystal, you have more defined, narrow bands, just like with a UV-Vis and luminescence spectra. While in the glass, the bands become more combined and merge into each other, and it's less well-resolved. So first of all, some differences in taking infrared and Raman spectra. And one is infrared spectroscopy measures the absorption in resonance. So you just have your probe beam with different infrared wavelengths and see where you have the absorption in your glass. It's faster to use a Fourier transform and not going through each wavelength one at a time as you do with UV-Vis spectroscopy. So that's the FT-IR, and that's the microscope you have here is working like that. So it just measures everything at the same time, and then it's a complicated calculation to separate the different wavelengths again. But it just is faster, and the distance in energy for the different infrared wavelengths is large enough to do that. So with UV-Vis, you would have a problem in doing Fourier transform and measuring all the wavelengths at the same time. The distance is just too close to really do that. With Raman, you only select one probe beam. You don't go through the infrared spectra, you just select one, and most of the time it's in the visible spectrum. Most because if you go to the infrared, you usually use intensity. And if you go to the UV, you might either have too high energies and hurt your sample, or you need different optics. So it's just cheaper to have the instrument working in the visible. But sometimes we had one laser in Jena working at 325 nanometer, which is really nice to get away from some fluorescing ions, and gave quite good spectrum. So instead of going through all the wavelengths, you only excite with one, and then you have this inelastic scattering and measure the shift in energy from your probe beam and the scattering that you get back. So that's so you measure relative to your probe beam here, and here you measure directly if the probe beam is absorbed or not. So the Raman spectrum gives you also a lot of freedom in with the samples. Just put some powders there or block, or can even have gas inside a cuvette and or little liquid. It's you really are kind of free in what you're doing. And you measure directly in the visible, so there's normal atmosphere, the optics works, so you don't have to. Only if you go to the UV, you have to change the optics. And you can, and even yeah, like in high pressure cells, if you have a diamond window, you can measure inside when you increase the pressure of the sample and see if there's structural changes and stuff. So with infrared, it's a little bit, you want to measure the full range, but if you go below 300, 400 frequencies, then the air will absorb everything. And so if you do that, you have to purge your instrument with like molecules that don't absorb, or you have to work in the vacuum. The other thing is, if you go below like 500 frequency values, you need different optics, because then the if you use certain KBR windows also, it won't pass through anymore. So you have to change the optics, which makes the whole thing more time consuming and more expensive. And while they both give you information on the structure of the glass, they see different things. So the Raman spectra are sensitive for change in polarization of the bond. By the infrared, that sees a change in the molecular dipole of the bond. So while the bond is vibrating, and I will show some examples, the dipole can change or not, and then it's this mode is infrared active or not. Another thing is with the Raman microscope, you can have a really nice spatial resolution. So you can pick out crystals in your glass. Little inclusions go here, there. You can do a cross-section mapping from the surface into the sample and see what's happening with every half micrometer. You're going deeper into your sample. So it's, of course, this depends on the microscope you're using, on the objective, on the laser, the excitation wavelength you're using. So the smaller, the higher the energy, the better the resolution. With infrared, you're using infrared wavelengths, so they are huge, and so the resolution is huge. They say that some of the microscope can go to like 30, 60 micrometer, but usually below 100 micrometer, it's not. I haven't seen it working really good below. And you still need a perfect, a flat surface for infrared. The surface does matter a lot. If you measure in reflectance, then you need a good surface that the light is reflected. And if you want to look, for example, to an indent, then that's not flat. And then the light is reflected somewhere else and not to your detector. And because here you are measuring scattering, it's not that sensible to the surface. So if you have a rough, it's still often better if you have a polished glass, but you still can get nice spectra from breaks and just your untreated glass and even from powder. Generally, there are different versions, the near-infrared, the mid-infrared, and the far-infrared. For structural discussions, you're always in the area of the mid-infrared. That's what you have, your stretching and bending modes, and that's what you can measure here with a microscope, and what most Raman instruments also see. The near-infrared, it's a lot of UV spectrometer actually measure up to the near-infrared. So if you want to see how much water is inside your glass and not just on the surface, you take a transmission spectrum with the near-infrared UV spectrometer. The one here in the other room, I think it only goes to 1050, so it's okay, technically the near-infrared starts after the visible, say at 800 nanometer, but you are still more or less there. But if you go to one that can go to 3000 nanometer, you get the water bands. and you, which are then absorptions due to the structure and the vibrations of the water molecules and not to some electron transitions, like with the manganese and the other dopants. And the far infrared, that's this very low frequency range, which for infrared, for example, it gives you the vibration of the cations, the modified cations against the lattice. So against the cages of the silicates around it. So it really gives you, it's one of the few methods that can give you some more about the environment of sodium, for example, in a soda lime glass. And depending on the band position, it seeks out higher or lower basicity sites. So it's, NMR can do it for some cations, but far infrared can do it for pretty much all of them. And the other thing is, if you measure in reflectance and you want to calculate the absorption spectra from the reflectance spectra, you have to have the full absorption spectra, because you have to extrapolate the high frequencies to infinity and the low frequency to zero. And if you measure only to 500, there are still bands below 500. There are still some deformation modes, sometimes even bending modes or the cation vibrations. So it's hard to say to do the extrapolation to zero. So to do that, you really have to measure the full range. So you can't do that here with a microscope because you don't have the vacuum function. But you still have good reflectance spectra. So you can compare them. If you have a series of glasses, you can say, okay, this band is going, this one is going somewhere else. This is a crystal, this is a glass. So you can get a lot of information from this one. But you can't do the full transformation into an absorption spectrum. But I don't know if you have that, but there is a possibility to add an ATR unit to your instrument. So ATR, attenuated total reflectance, which is a, and I have some slides, but it's actually, it's measuring in reflectance, but in the sample is pressured to the detector and the probe beam, so that there is a tunneling of the waves into your glass sample. So an evanescent field of the waves is there. So you can actually, you get an absorption spectra from that, and you can do that with powders. You just have to press them really strong on the detector, on your usually a diamond window or something. So it's for, if you have powdered glass samples, it's a great way to do quick measurements and get the absorption spectrum. Okay, with Raman, it says you're exciting with one wavelength, and then a vibrational state is excited from the ground state to an excitation state. And then as it falls back, it emits light, and that's the light you're collecting. And this difference is different from the probe beam energy. So it's an inelastic effect, and you measure the difference in energy. And with infrared, you're pretty much in the absorption modus, and you measure the wavelength that's absorbed. So now there are some examples on the dipole change and the polarization change. And this is a hydrogen fluoride molecule, and it's a very big negative charged fluoride atom and a small positive hydrogen atom. And yes, there is an ionic bond and it's vibrating, but the dipole in this molecule is permanent. It doesn't matter how much the hydrogen is moving around, it's always you have the negative charge here and the very small positive there. So this is always Raman active, but not infrared. So the dipole stays the same, there's no change in the dipole, you won't get a band in the infrared spectrum. And these are examples now for water molecules. The symmetric and the asymmetric stretching mode, and then a bending mode here. And yeah. And here you have a larger dipole moment than here. So there is a change in the dipole moment. And also in this asymmetric, you can have a much larger or much smaller dipole moment. And the same here with the bending. So the dipole moment is changing for all three cases. So they're all infrared active. And here, this brownish cloud, that's to show the polarization ellipsoid. And you see that it's much smaller here for for the vibration mode when it has all the hydrogen next to the oxygen, and then it's much larger when you push them far away. And the same here, when they're halfway through, it's smaller, and then you also see a change in the cloud. And same here, you see a change in the polarization. So they're all Raman active as well as infrared active. There is this alternative prohibition rule for infrared and Raman also, but that's only working for molecules that have a center of symmetry, where you will see that they're either Raman active or infrared active. But you see from the water molecule, a lot of bands can be both, but they don't have to be both. So that's the next examples. That's carbon dioxide. So yes, there is a center of symmetry. So for some modes, we see that they're either Raman or infrared active. Again here, the dipole moment always stays the same, because the negative charges there, they have a different but always the same distance. So if you middle the average of the dipole moment, it stays the same. So this mode is infrared inactive. Here you have a bigger difference here, or smaller there. So the center of the dipole moment, that changes. And so for this molecule, you get a change in the dipole moment, so it's infrared active. And the same here, so it goes out of the plane, and you have a change in dipole moment, so it's another infrared active mode. And for the polarization cloud, it's the other way around. So in this, the dipole moment stays the same, but you have a small or large polarization cloud. So it's Raman active. But here the overall size and the orientation of this polarization cloud remains the same. It's more like if you only look at the black, at the carbon, then that it's moving between the two oxygen, but the whole polarization stays the same. So it's Raman inactive, but as we've seen it before, infrared active. And so for this symmetric molecule, you have this rule that it's either Raman or infrared active. And that's why I said at the beginning, it's complementary, the methods. So, and if you know the symmetry of your molecules, you can actually calculate the number of vibrations, and you can say if they're infrared or Raman active. Of course, they're always, like in glasses, you can have distortions, and then a symmetric mode becomes more asymmetric, and you might see them in the infrared spectra, even so you weren't supposed to. But I mean, that's another way of getting more information from the spectrum. And now, this sulfate tetrahedra are distorted, that's why I see them decreasing here. I'll talk most about the reflection spectra, because that works best for glasses, but I will shortly talk about the other two. So a lot of papers you will find, they have been measured in transmission. And yes, that's how we did it with the doped glasses, with the optical spectra, we measure in transmission. The thing is, you usually have saturation very early on. So infrared radiation, glasses are not transparent for infrared. That's why we measure that for the structure. And it's the structure that absorbs. And so we need very thin samples to measure in transmission. And one, 5 to 15 micrometers. So that's not your average bulk glass. And you can have a film on infrared transparent material. And that could be like a KBR substrate. Or you can put it on a silicon wafer. And the pure SE silicon matter, it's transparent for infrared radiation, so you can measure it there. But the structure of your thin film material might be quite different from a bulk glass. You have different ways of preparing such thin films. You do have only the very thin surface, so the structure might be different. And while you measure it, you can get distortions through this oscillating fringes. Just as the light is, your probe beam is kind of trapped inside the film and reflected between the substrate and the film, and then you get those waves. And then if you want to see how the intensity of some bands is changing here, it does make a difference if you're just in the veil or the peak of these fringes. So that makes evaluation just a little bit more difficult. Actually, if you know the refractive index of your film, then from the distance between peak to peak, you can actually calculate the thickness of the film, or if you know the thickness and the peaks, you can get to get the, so it's correlated to the refractive index of your glass. So you can play a bit even with these measurements. What you will see much more often is the measurement by KBR pellets. So you ground your glass, mix it with KBR and make a pellet out of it, and then you measure the reflectance. But now the problem is you do have glass grains inside your KBR pellet, and of course the light will be scattered around the infrared and radiation. So you will get a lot of different effects overlaying each other. So actually, if you want to do it right, you need exact grain sizes. And I usually do it differently, so I don't have all the numbers in my head, but there are papers on what grain size would be good, and you shouldn't have a big distribution of large and small particles, because that will distort your spectrum. You will have, and that's not something you can get around, always a combination of transmission and reflection phenomena. And so you get an intermediate of transversal optical and longitudinal optical modes. So your spectrum are kind of distorted. You lose some spectral features like band shape and separation, and some of the band intensities might be slightly different. Yeah. Because that's transparent to infrared. So you try to dilute your glass by making a powder and putting it in a transparent solution, and this time a solid solution by having glass grains in a transparent KBR pellet. And now another problem is that KBR is kind of gives you hydrolysis kind of easily. And if you powder your glass, you have a big surface, so you have more surface to hydrolyze your glass. So in a way, you can get just changes from your bulk glass because you have hydrolysis supported by the KBR pellets and by the big surface by preparing your glass powder. And you can have ion exchange from the potassium in the KBR with your glass. So you're changing the structure of your glass by the measurement. So that's some of the spectrum, the problems I have when doing infrared spectra with KBR pellets. And you're losing sensitivity. And if you measure 10 times the same glass, but each time you powder and make your different KBR pellets, your spectra will look differently. So that's the attenuated total reflectance method, which is nice if you have powders. It doesn't really work for glass, bulk glasses. And I'll explain shortly why. But the thing is, you have a little black dot here in the center, and that's your detector window. And that's where you put your sample on it. And then you, with this one, you just press your powdered sample onto this window really strong so that there's nothing between the window and your sample, that they really have a close contact. And yeah, usually you measure under air, so you start measuring somewhere above 500, but and you can put it, you can actually combine it with the microscope you have here. So it's just can work with the same thing. And the trick is the infrared radiation comes from this below and hits the surface of your, yeah, it's a little ATR crystal here, and your sample was on top, and it's really close contact, no air between, directly on the ATR crystal. And then the light is reflected. You have a total reflectance, but some of the light waves, they form this evanescent field inside your glass sample. So it's kind of tunneling into your sample, but it's the real probe beam, it's reflected, but part of the wave, the electromagnetic wave, still goes into your sample. And this part that goes into your sample that absorbs, or will be absorbed, some of that will be absorbed by your sample, so that in the end, what the probe beam that comes back to the detector will now show this absorption. So you measure in absorption on your glass powder, but in reflectance. And this way, you get quite good spectra with a good resolution. Most instruments now convert this measured transmission spectra directly into an absorption spectra. And that's a true absorption spectra where you can now then do band fitting and things. So the position of the bands is exactly where they would be if you do the reflectance and Kramers-Kronig transformation. And it's nice because you don't need the best polished big glass samples, but you can do that with powder. And I know that in Jena, especially the bio group, they're often going to the organic chemistry department because they have usually one of these instruments and have their samples measured there. So I don't know if there's one here in São Carlos, but it's a nice way. So they're usually following their apatite growth in their samples over time. And it's a quick measurement. Yeah, and what you do have here, here the ATR unit can be put into this spectrometer that goes with the microscope, and you do have these. So you can measure in transmission if you want. You can measure in reflectance. And with the microscope, you can pick the place you want to go. Of course, you can't do the vacuum part with this, but it's very fast. You can measure lots of samples or mapping. If you have, like we had electrodes put to a sample and then we could make a cross section and see how the structure of the glass is different, where the electrode was attached to the pristine area before and after. And so here it's, yeah, the spectra do depend on a wavelength dependence of the probe beam and well, of the interaction of your material with the light that's coming. So you measure the frequency dependent refractive and absorption index, and the incident angle makes a difference. So if you have under the microscope not a plain parallel sample, but a tilted sample, then the spectrum might look different. So it's here the sample geometry does play a role, and a bigger role than with Raman spectroscopy. So you get the dispersion function of the absorption coefficient and the real fraction, the real fraction index, and both of them are dependent of the frequency and give you the reflectivity. So in the end, that's just an infrared spectrum of the air. and transmission spectra. And if you are here below 500, you will see that the transmission is really, really low. So otherwise, you always have to measure the background first, and then the instrument will just take it off your measurement. You will often have some sharp peaks around 1600, that's carbon dioxide. 2000, 3000, there might be water. And if you measure in this little room, then people are coming, people are going, people are breathing. So there will be more water and more CO2 in the air if you're working there for a while. Then, you can always run a new reference spectrum. The other thing is you save the reference spectrum, and then you know you can overlay your measured spectrum with the reference, and you see, oh, this peak is just there where we have that CO2 band. So we don't take that serious for the discussion of the sample. We know it's just the background atmosphere. And now this is something since you can't do the Kramers-Kronig transformation here. You don't really have to know how to do it, but I just wanted to tell you that there are ways. If you measure in reflectance, if you measure in the vacuum and get the full spectral range, that the reflectivity you are measuring at the end depends on the refractive index, which is dependent on the frequency. And you get with n as the real refractive index, and k is the imaginary refractive index. So you, and the measured reflectivity can be transformed to get the phase angle difference between the reflected and the incident wave. And so with this formulas, you can then actually separate the real and the imaginary part of the refractive index from the measurements. And now I don't do it by hand. It's the program of the instrument that allows you to do it. But in order to do that, first you have to extrapolate, as I said, to infinity and to zero of your spectrum for the wavelengths. So that's why you need to measure the full range. So that's the Fresnel formulas that allow you to separate those two things. And if you have K, so the imaginary part of the refractive index, and together with the frequency where the K was measured, and for P you get the absorption coefficient, which then is equivalent to the absorption spectra of your glass. So if you had an infrared transient material, measure the transmission and calculate the absorption spectrum from that, you would get the same value as you get here from the reflectivity data. And that's like a spectrum as it looks when you measure the reflectance. And here it's the separated, the real part of the refractive index, and here K, the imaginary part. And you see that there are some shifts in the position of the maxima and minima, and that also the intensities are quite different. Like here, the 800, it's hidden here. So, if you do the 4 PKF, multiply this K spectrum with the frequency at each point and 4P, you get to the absorption spectra. And in the absorption spectra, the low frequency bands are much smaller and the high frequency band much higher in intensity than if you go directly from the reflectance to K. And this is what you have to compare if you measure directly in reflectance as you do here, and then with the absorption spectra you would have if you did the full thing. The position of the bands is slightly shifted and the intensity is different. The good thing is if you have a glass series, 5 glasses, and we have, I don't know, increasing tempering, increasing crystallization, or you increase the modifier oxide content in respect to silicate content, you will see the same trends, relative trends. Or this band might be going up, the other band is going down. So you can discuss those trends, and you can discuss the band shape, if the position are shifting. And so relative to each other, you can do all of that. And this one, if you really want to go deep down and do like a band fit, you can't do band fitting here and quantify, but you can quantify it here. The thing is, here you have to find someone who has the instrument and can do that. If you have, for screening, the microscope is great. Like in one afternoon, you can measure 100 samples and then you know what's going on here and there. And then if you pick just a handful of those and like, as I do, measure those in Athens, we can easily do that for 5, but for here, like 100 samples in the afternoon, no problem. Here you can perhaps measure 10 samples on a day if you start early and finish late. So it takes much, much longer to do the vacuum and evacuation and the whole thing. But yeah, for screening, this is great. For finding different pieces to say, oh, this is the same as that. If the reflectance spectra are the same, yes, the absorption spectra would be the same too. And to see where the trend is going, you can get a lot of from just from the original reflectance without doing the Kramers Kronig. There's something else you can calculate from the reflectance spectrum. And that's the electric constants and the optical conductivity of the glasses. So there's a similar set of formulas. And in the end, it's just from one reflectance spectrum, you can get the imaginary real part of the refractive index. And with that, the absorption, what sigma is standing for. And then you get the dielectric and the optical conductivity spectra. And you see that there are some differences in all of these. So I'm just saying that because it's possible to go much deeper into it. I usually just go to the absorption spectra and look at the structure, but it's, for some questions, it might be interesting to go into those as well. But then probably good to work with someone who has done it before. and there are ways to calculate the spectra as well and to do simulations. And I think it's much better than they used to be with the modulation and calculation, but it's still with glasses, you often, there are bands that don't show up, or there are bands that show up at 3 different places instead of just at 1. So it's in glass. You often have, and you have a coupling of bands. And so it's not that easy to do with the calculations, but I think today they're getting much better, the simulation of the spectra, than they used to be. If you go to the standard infrared books and Raman, you will always find that you can, just from the degree of freedoms, and you can calculate the number of modes you will see, but it's, and then to see which are active in infrared and which are active in Raman. So there are ways to do that, but as I said, with glasses, you don't have the perfect symmetric tetrahedral. You have distortions, it's connected to others, so it's a bit more complicated to that. But what you do have, that you do have the basic vibrations directly, and then you can have overtone modes and combination modes. So sometimes you get frequency has doubled the frequency of your main band. And so you don't have to find a new assignment for that. If it's exactly doubled of your first band, then it's probably a overtone mode. Or it can be a combination so that the position, the energies of 2 of your strong bands, they give you a smaller band at the sum of their frequencies. And yeah, if you do a quantification of the infrared spectra, just like with the molar extinction coefficient for the dopants, different modes have different intensities. So this is metaborate glasses, and these are BO3 groups, and these are bands connected to BO4 groups. And from the area under the infrared spectra, you now can have an idea of the population of BO3 and BO4 groups and the ratio for them. But it's you can't take them one to one because there is a factor of 1.3 that one is absorbing stronger than the other. So the trigonal and the tetrahedral borate absorb infrared with different factors. So in order to quantify and really say we have so and so many percent BO3 groups and so many percent BO4, we have to calibrate with NMR spectroscopy, which allows us to quantify the BO4 and the BO3 group. In the end, it's still worth doing that because we have samples here like the copper borate or the manganese borate, which are paramagnetic, so NMR can't measure them. And if we do it by infrared, but we use the spectra of lead and zinc and some other borates where we do have the NMR results, we know the BO3, BO4 fraction, we can calculate the absorption cross sections and then go into the quantification. Or another way is, so for band assignments, yes, calculating and knowing where band positions are is of course important. The other thing is you go to a material, usually crystals, where the structure is well known. So you know how many BO4, how many BO3 groups, and then you see if you have absorption in the area. So we know now this is BO4 groups, this is BO3 groups, just from comparison with crystalline materials. So that's where the first borate bands were. Usually you were discussing the glasses together with the crystals and try to get the assignments. For rings, you often have ring breathing modes, but they are more active in Raman than in infrared. And sometimes they tried with isotopes to change the mass. And with all the vibrational modes, they depend hugely on the mass. So you get shifts of bands if you substitute one element by an isotope that's slightly more heavier or lighter. And then you can see the shifts in the bands and say, okay, this is changing because I changed the mass of this element. So this bending mode is connected to this unit where I do have this isotope inside. These are some examples of the far infrared. So the bands you can only see if you measure in vacuum. And we see, for example, that the band for barium is shifting if we change the magnesium to barium ratio. We also see that for magnesium, we can't say that directly because we do have lithium aluminum in this glass and they all absorb here. It's overlays. And if you look at infrared spectra, they have much more bands than the Raman spectra. So we have a lot of overlap of different bands. But here for the barium, we really see how the mode of the barium ions are shifting. And for some borate glasses, Dr. Skomitzos has whole series of looking in the far infrared bands, and he sees different positions for different glasses, and also that there are two for the same ion. So there is a high basicity site and a low basicity site. So one could be in a site with more non-bridging oxygen, the other is more connected to bridging oxygen, for example. And so depending on the ion, they were really well defined, separated bands, and for others, it's just one. We usually find if we mix a high field strength ion with a low field strength ion, the high field strength ion would go to the high basicity site, the favorite site with the non-bridging oxygen, and the other one has to go what's left. So the barium is usually the one that has no choice and is forced into the unfavored low basicity site. This slide is kind of to show the difficulty sometimes with band assignments in the infrared. If you have a borosilicate glass, there are a lot of frequencies where you will see very different origins for this band. And so usually there, yeah, you can put silicate bands there, or you might put borite bands there. And of course, if you have a borosilicate glass, there are mixed bridges from boron oxygen to silicon. And with boron, you have the 3 and the 4-fold, and then you get all the different combinations. So sometimes it gets a bit more complicated. But that's why it's good to always to have other methods as well. So if you have information from NMR that gives you the BO4 and BO3 ratio, that's something to go with, because if you know that you have a lot of BO4 in the glass, then yes, you have to find the BO4 stretching modes somewhere in the infrared spectra. Also, that's why doing both infrared and Raman spectroscopy is so helpful. With Raman, you also have overlap, but you usually have less bands in the Raman. And if you find some symmetric stretching modes in the Raman and asymmetric in the infrared, it would be good if they kind of belong to the same species. And so if you say with Raman that you have a lot of BO4 groups in the glass, but with infrared you don't see BO4, that's where you have to rethink your assignments. And so they should work together, the infrared and the Raman spectra. And if you have information from NMR, for example, that should collaborate and support what the assignments you did with the other one. And if you have there's also a shift often for the bending modes or the deformation modes depending on what's inside. So for how many non-bridging oxygen you have. So for if you have a lot of Q3 groups in a glass, it's also the not just the stretching modes, but also the bending and the deformation modes that look differently. And that all should work together for the assignments. And one problem with infrared and Raman spectroscopy is that there are lots of papers which don't have good assignments inside. They just copied what they found somewhere else that could fit their assignments. So they know what they want to see, and then they cite the papers that have bands there. But as I just showed, there are some pages where some frequency sphere can have a lot of different assignments. So in the end, it's good to go back to those papers who really have a very systematic change of composition, who have reference materials from crystals, and discuss also about the geometry and if it should be active or not, and if they compare Raman infrared. So the good papers, you usually see that they have a lot of thoughts of their assignments and discuss why they do that. And others just have a reference, and then you don't know. So it's sometimes a bit tricky to find the good reference spectrum. And now we are almost out of time. But I wanted to show some examples on infrared spectroscopy, and that's a 3,000-year-old Mycenaean soda lime silicate glass. And we archaeologists in Greece did all the quantitative analysis. And then we started doing some infrared spectroscopy on those. And later some Newton tomography. That's the sample I had, and you will see them in the museum that they often have a gold layer on top of, outside these. So they were found in those and burial tombs of Mycenaean time. The samples I had were from this area, but the pictures were from here, southern Peloponnese. And they found these glass, and they were sometimes, I think the longest jewelry was like 60 meters long, and they were so meter long jewelry out of blue glass. They just loved the blue glass.
Sorry, what do you mean by this one, the jewelry?
Chains
necklaces,
and arms, and they were sewing the fragments to the burial dress. So it's always small things. They never found a vase, or there might be one, and they aren't sure if it's original Mycenaean or if it's imported. But there might be one vase, but it's lots of fragments, and they're sewn or necklaces, or And so they are kind of, from the composition, there should be Q3 units only. So you have 3 bitching and 1 non-bitching oxygen, and it's a lot of calcium and sodium, little bit of magnesium, potassium, so they probably used wood ash and plant ash for the preparation. And that's the infrared reflectance spectrum you would expect to see. That's the stretching modes of the Q3 group. And this shoulder is probably it's too high for a Q2 group. So it's a bit of a question. And I learned the assignments differently than Ben learned the assignments. So there's still some discussion out here. So one view would be that a Q3 group that's connected to a Q2 group would be shifted with energies here, or it's if you have change from the cation sodium to calcium, you might see a shift. And Ben will probably tell more in the Raman spectra. Sometimes you know that there are more bands here, but the assignments are still not that clear. Here it's the bending modes that we know, so the SEO, SE. You see that here, and then the deformation and the rest of the network. And that's just for comparing. That's a bioglass where you have 50% Q2, 50% Q3 units. And so this is would be those two, the Q3 and the Q2 group. And you see the increase in frequency from a Q2 to a Q3 to a Q4 unit. And in infrared, for example, you see this huge absorption for the stretching modes of a fully polymerized SU04 tetrahedra. Next Monday in the Raman spectra, you will see that Raman is pretty much almost blind to a full polymerized SU04. So there's a very small thing here. But it does see with good intensity the Q2 and Q3 groups. And also this splitting, we know that's a splitting of the main stretching mode and probably transversal and longitudinal optical mode. So that's typical for fully polymerized glass. Like a B203, you would also see this shoulder at the high energy side. And it's always, if you have a fully polymerized higher energies, the more you depolymerize, you see a shift to lower energies. Now we measured this glass, and here the microscope was handy because with a vacuum full infrared spectrometer, you need a big flat surface. And here we have corroded areas, we do have a relief. So with the microscope, we could find a clear spot here. So instead of the green spectra with the Q3 units, what we expected, we get on the front and the back something that looks almost like the spectrum of a pure SO2 glass. And if we go at the broken edges, then we have something that looks much more like the bioglass. In a way, we can explain both by corrosion. If water attacks the network, it gets dissolved. We get the formation of more non-bridging oxygen. So that's what's happened on the breaks. And we can also, if you have a solution first and you get the ion exchange, I will show some slides there how that comes. You can actually have a corrosion layer that is, after it dries, becomes like a pure SO2 layer on your glass. But this band at 920, that's not typical for an SO2 glass, it's absent here. And we do see this band in borosilicate glasses, but it could also be a hydrogen connected to a silicate, so an SEOH group, which would be in line with a corrosion effect. And these are spectra from publications where they looked at the sodium silicate and leached it, and then they dried it again. And they see that the Q3 groups transform into Q4. And they also, at some point, they do have a little band here, but it's not so well resolved like in our Mycenaean sample. So the one here. And that's the problem, as I said before, that if you have different, there are several assignments possible for some sites. So it's not sometimes you need extra information. And this is just how the Sol-Gel thing works. So you have your glass and water, you get the hydroxide groups, and then you dry it again, and then after the ice changed, you now lost the sodium and the calcium for your glass. You dry the glass and you get an SO2 layer outside. So yes, it can, corrosion could explain why we get this. And here we have examples from the white spots, from the corroded areas. And that's like the sample, the literature example. So we have an unresolved shoulder here, and then bands that are in agreement with SO4 fully polymerized groups. We also see oscillating fringes as the light is trapped in the corroded films. We also have carbonate salts, a lot of bands here. We have water. So here, would be water, this would be water. And we don't really have much water in the blue layer where we have the well-resolved shoulder. So in the corroded area, yes, we do have the Sol-Gel and then a polymerization in the SO2 layer. But here, there isn't much water here and no water absorption here. And we have a much better band here. So it's hard to put this into an SEOH vibration if you don't have the OH vibrations here. And this also shows how surface-sensitive infrared spectroscopy is. That's the penetration depth of the infrared radiation into your glass sample. And of course, again, it's wavelength dependent. But it's between 10 and 0.1 micrometer. So that's not very deep. With Raman, you can probe deeper into the sample. So it's a great method if you want to look at changes in the surface of your glass. And otherwise, you just have to trust that you have really polished the glass so good that you're in an area that represents the bulk glass. We had some classic Hellenic Greek glass samples, and that's the Raman spectra, Q2, Q3 groups as expected. And the infrared of these surfaces. And here we know that, and I will talk about the borate in the next slides. So we know that there was no contact with boron, and here we have the Q2 and the Q3 groups. But again, only a very weak shoulder, not this well-resolved band we had before. And in this glass, huge water band, and where we also have this silicon OH group. So that goes with the water. If it's really separated here and the band here, then yes, it's a silicon OH. But here we do have this band without the water band. So the other thing is here on the left side, you see in blue, that's two low alkali borosilicate glasses. They have no water there, but they also have this absorption here, and that's a tetrahedral borate BO4 group. This would be the trigonal, the BO3 group, and a Polish sample laying around in the lab for 10 years lost all the tetrahedral BO3 on the surface. Infrared reflectance, so yes, we only see what's lost from the surface. So after 3,000 years, I wouldn't expect to see any BO3 groups, but we still would see the BO4. And just for comparison, the vitreous SO2, where we don't have a band, here at 920, 950. And there's an old text from Schliemann who explained that the Mycenaean goldsmith already knew how to use borax when they were working their gold. And there was a gold coin found with some borax next to it. So our idea was, since most of the samples you see in the museum is gilded on the outside, that the goldsmith gilding the samples might have used borax to attach the gold to the glass, or perhaps they worked at higher temperatures and in order to prevent the gold from oxidizing and turning black, they used the borax. What some goldsmiths today still do. And borax is also suggested today as an alternative for mercury in the extraction of gold from silicate ores. And in Turkey, which isn't far from Greece, they do have gold. They excavate, find gold. They have sources of gold, and they do have borax sources. So they could have access to both the gold and the borax. So the idea was you start with the glass with the Q3 groups. Then you gild the glass and have borax. And so you form a borosilicate glass. Then over the next 3,000 years, to have some reaction with water, the BO3 groups disappear. The BO4, they are tightly inside the glass matrix, so you keep them. And one thing is the cobalt. We know it prefers the borate sites. It's connected to borate, and we still have a nice blue glass. So the cobalt wasn't leached out of the glass. Also, the leaching experiments, when you form this SO2 layer via this Zorogil method, when it shrinks, you get a lot of cracks in the glass. But our glass, there wasn't that much shrinking. Probably before the BO4 is still inside, so it was less Zorogil, less leaching. And so we wanted to try if we can create a borosilicate layer outside on a glass sample. And we have a gold shield, some borax powder, and we didn't have such a nice mold, but we just added that to each other. And gave a bit too much glass to the gold shield. But we have the glass, we have the gold shield, and only direct next to the glass we see some borax crystals, but otherwise we don't. And this is a picture from Newton tomography. Now, one problem was with the 3,000-year-old Greek sample, you're not allowed to take it out of the country. You're not allowed to look at it destructively. So we did some experiments with our remade glass where we could cut the glass and destroy it and do whatever we want with it. And we got a measurement time at the Paul Scherer Institute in Switzerland for neutron tomography. The neutron are absorbed by boron really nicely. And so we hoped that we can see the borosilicate layer. And all the light spots here, that's borosilicate forming on this soda lime silicate glass. And it's only on the outside, and so that worked. One problem, that's the reactor and doing the measurements and one of those things. And every time you want to leave the building, you have to prove that you're not contaminated. And, and what it does, so it's there are neutrons hitting your sample, and the sample is on a rotational stage. So it's the neutrons come from all sides. And in the end, you can, of course, you get a little movie of a film. I will show that. And then you can actually calculate. Didn't show that. No. Like a medical tomography, you can really see the slices of your sample and then see where, if it's only outside or inside. So now we see here the dark spots. That's just an inverted to the first picture. That's where the boron is in the site. And if we measure infrared reflectance with a microscope in the lighter areas, we see the typical solar lime silicate spectrum with the Q3 groups, no boron bands. And if we go, that's the next one. Let's see the movie first. So yeah, here you see that the boron is really only on the outside of the sample. And it's covering quite a huge area of the glass. And we only had a little borax powder on the gold sheet. But by pouring it, it really went everywhere. And if we now go to the dark spots, we see BO3 groups. We measured directly and not after 3,000 years. We also see the shoulder, 940, which is the BO4 groups. And there are also the bending modes, the SEO. So that the boron is, you see that here, it's different from the spectrum here. So you see at three points in the infrared spectra the proof for the borate part, which is really nice. But the thing is, that's how you can calculate the the slides afterwards. We didn't really need that for our spectrum. We just was okay to see it outside. But if you go to an archaeological site now, the problem is that, yes, neutrons absorb, but hydrogen scatters neutrons. So again, we get, even for hydrolyzed samples, we get the signals there. So it's, yes, we showed it's working for a water-free sample, but for these samples, it's, we didn't have the nice ones from the earlier infrared spectros. They were back with the museum. So eventually we could prove that this method is working. Now it might be easier to get permission for new samples. But in the end, we also want to try something else, and that might be with the Corning Museum in the US. They do have some Icenium glasses, and they have next to it the Corning plant and the research station. So we might want to try solid state NMR. So without powdering and spinning, but just looking if there are BO4 groups in this glass. But infrared spectroscopy is surface sensitive, non-destructive, and you can pick out the different sites on your sample. So it allowed us to see the BO4 groups. A lot of techniques are too high in energy for the light element born. Raman wasn't working because there's too much other things in the glass. We have lots of fluorescence. Little bit of antimony, little bit of manganese. So that's where infrared is really nice. Now, thank you for staying late. And next time it's all about Raman.
Thank you. Thank you a lot. Very interesting examples. Lots of things to do.
Yeah.
Any questions? Any comment? So,
I have only one curious
yes.
Because I observed some graphs have initiate the X-layer to the major number as the minor number. All these graphs initiate in the minor number to the major number. Understand?
In a way, it's up to you how you plot them. And I start from low frequency to high frequency, and I do it for infrared and Raman, so I have both of them next to each other and I can see. I have the big absorption here and there, and so it's easier to compare it. But you will find different literature, and I think if the opus, the program of the microscope, will start with the high to the low numbers, so you can change that in the program. But it's, in a way, it's just what you are used to and how you think about doing it. And as long as it's written clearly, then every publication will take both of them. For me, it's by comparing infrared and Raman all the time, it was easier to do it this way.
How is that more common?
Well, I'm always submitting my publications from low to high numbers, and I never had any complaint about that yet. So I think that's rather typical now, but they won't tell you that you are wrong if you do it the other way.
Okay.